Morning, everyone.
Evan, did you pick that scripture reading out, or was that the scheduled scripture reading?
Wow, that's perfect timing. We're not going to be talking about that, but I hold that passage near and dear to my heart when I think about this congregation. My name is Chase. It's good to see everyone today. This congregation has supported me in the work in Harrisburg for 4 years coming up in January. You all have been with me from the very beginning, from the time I was young, coming up through Bible classes here, to now moving and working with a congregation in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Which when I moved there, there were six of us. And now by God's grace, there's 50 of us. And we've just had a tremendous amount of growth. And Lord willing, tonight, in tonight's lesson, I'm going to do a bit of a teaser. I'm not going to get into all the details of what the work in Harrisburg has been like today. But tonight, I'm going to do a more detailed report on that. I'm going to have pictures, some updates, and things like that. So I'd encourage you to come back at 5:30. Come back at 5:30. And you'll get to hear a little bit about the work there in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. So again, thank you all so much for your love and support. My heart goes out to you all. I think about the words of Paul there in Philippians 4, that from the very beginning, you all have been with me. And so I thank you for that. But for this morning's lesson, I want to start by asking everyone a pretty simple question. Have you ever been lied to before? I hope everyone in here is saying yes. And if your answer is no, see me afterwards and I'll tell you how I can bench press 200 pounds. But I'll tell you what, no one likes to be lied to. Even people who are liars don't like to be lied to, because it's not the truth. It's a false reality. Everything we see and everything we do and every decision we make is based off of the truth that's been given to us. And so if it's false, if it's not real, we're making decisions that might be false. You ever had a spouse that lied to you? Or maybe if you haven't, can you imagine what it would be like to be in a marriage where your spouse is constantly lying to you? Everything that builds a relationship is built on truth. It is so important for us. And that's why I want to talk about that today. I want to talk to the very idea of what truth is. And the reason why I want to talk about this, is just to be frank with everyone in here, is because over the last few years, I've had a lot of loved ones, family members and not family members, that have left the truth. Some men who've stood in this pulpit who've left the truth. Some people that I grew up with that left the truth. And I know I'm not the only one in here that has experienced that. It hurts when someone we love walks away from the truth. And as Hebrews 10 will say, it deliberately walks away. And in some of those cases, it's brethren who I've loved and respected who just left the truth to go to the world and to go live in sin and pleasure because they know if they continue to walk a Christian lifestyle, they can't do the things that they want to do. And some of those brethren, they've just simply walked off into false doctrine, false teaching altogether. And in both cases, it hurts. And that is why it is no surprise that the Bible has a lot to say about how important truth is. In fact, just to kind of warm us up this morning, let's look at just a few passages. Proverbs 3:3 says, "Do not let kindness and truth leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart." I was warned to take Sally down to her class and see that Dina has been teaching on this very passage, Proverbs 3 and verse 3. How critical is it for our children from a young age to understand that truth and kindness will take them throughout the rest of their lives? Going down into the Proverbs a little bit further, it will say, "Buy truth, do not sell it." Don't put it on Amazon. Get wisdom and instruction and understanding. Hang on to the truth as closely as you can. The New Testament says similar things. Jesus said, "He who practices the truth comes to the light so that his deeds may be manifested as have been being wrought in God." 8:31 of John. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. It's vital that we buy this truth, hang on to it, and never let it go. You know, people in the world would generally agree with these passages. They agree that truth is important. But you know, people want the truth, but they don't really want the truth. Maybe that sounds confusing. Let me maybe just say it a different way. People want the truth, but they don't want the truth. people have different standards of what truth is. And depending on what their standard is, it depends on how they live and how they act. And so what I want to do with the lesson this morning is kind of answer four questions with truth. As I was wrestling with the fact that several of my friends and loved ones have left the gospel of Christ for a different gospel, for a different truth, there were several questions that came to my mind. And I want to share those with you all this morning, as some in here might be wrestling with that idea themselves. And the first question is pretty simple. What does the truth do? What is it capable of? Look over at 2 Timothy chapter 2, because the first point we're going to make, and this is kind of the whole basis of the lesson, this is why I titled the lesson, Handling the Truth. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're going to start reading in verse 14. If you want to find your Bible, over to that passage. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 14. Paul's writing to a young evangelist named Timothy. And so you can imagine how vital this would be for him as he's working with a congregation. In verse 14, he says, Timothy, remind them of these things and solemnly charge them in the presence of God not to wrangle about words, which is useless and leads to the ruin of the hearers. It's very possible that Paul has a specific type of doctrine in mind. Possibly Gnosticism is what many think. But did you notice as he's talking about this doctrine of some kind, they wrangle about the words, and the end of it is it ruins the hearers. Paul goes on to say in verse 15, be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. And that right there is what we're going to talk about for a little bit. This idea that we are rightly handling or accurately handling the word of truth, that should be our desire. If you're a Greek nerd, this is a really cool Greek word. If you ever do Greek word searches, this one's kind of cool to kind of see the different places this one arises and the way that this word is used. In short, one of the Greek definitions for this is to make or cut straight and smooth, to handle aright, to teach the truth directly and correctly. My favorite one is a little more simple, to handle correctly, guide on a straight path. If you're reading from a King James version, it talks about rightly dividing the word of truth. Many in here might be familiar with that translation, with that idea. But this is exactly what Paul is trying to get Timothy to realize, that your job as an evangelist with that local church is to cut as straight as possible to the truth of the gospel. Don't muddy it up. I think about when I was hunting with Dad several years ago. My grandfather, my mom's dad, lived on a property that had a tree stand in the back and hadn't been accessed or used for years, and so we had to cut a path to get to the tree stand. And I remember we were trying to make that path as straight as we could so that that morning at 4 a.m. when we wake up, there wasn't a bunch of turns and curves that took us to the tree stand, but it was as straight as you could possibly get it so you could go right to the tree stand. And if you will, that's really what Paul is telling Timothy to do. Cut the path as straight as you can. Don't muddy it up with your own ideas, but make it straight for them. Timothy is going to help these brethren who are wrangling about words by showing them what the truth is in the clearest way he can. And we'll look at an application of that in just a second. In verses 16 through 18, I really think we see what are some results of leaving the truth behind. Verse 16 says, but avoid worldly and empty chatter, for it will lead to further ungodliness. If you're not talking about the bare bolts, the real things of the gospel, and just spending your time talking about these things that are just empty, they're worldly chatter, you're going down the wrong path. Verse 17, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus. Paul is notorious for name calling. I think sometimes we feel weird about that. Oh, we shouldn't mention if someone's believing a false doctrine. No, we should. Paul calls them out here for believing this and teaching this. And I think it's really important to see what Paul compares that false teaching to. It will spread like gangrene. Some ESV translations in here, it will say it will spread like cancer. And isn't that so true of false teaching? Some of the brethren that have been in here and that have been brethren for many, many years and maybe have worked with different churches or just been with this local congregation, they know how true this point is. One little bit of false teaching, one little bit of false doctrine gets in there. Before you know it, it is spread through the whole group. And I know it's actually happened with this local congregation at one time. And it's normally after the case, after the person has been exposed for the false doctrine that they've been teaching, that the local leaders or the eldership will kind of sit back and they'll be like, oh man, this has made it into many of the homes in this congregation. It spread so quickly because that's what false teaching does. And so you go back to Paul's main point, stick to the truth, cut it straight. Don't navigate away from it, but stay on course. Verse 18, Paul will say about these men, they've gone astray from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already taken place, and they upset the faith of some. That is what false teaching will do. When any man or woman dives into false teaching, they are not the only casualty. Likelihood is there's other people they have reached with that nonsense. And you know how I know that's true? Because that's happened to me. I'm sure it's happened to some of you as well. Have you all ever had someone you loved and respected and trusted as a gospel teacher or as a brother or sister in Christ that left the faith and as a result it upset your faith? I know I've certainly been there. That's why Paul is saying, cut it as straight as you possibly can, Timothy. And that's really what the application for us this morning is. Cut it straight, cut it smooth. That is the goal of any man who stands up here. Don't take us down unnecessary paths. Don't cut down trees that don't need to be cut down, if you will. Make the path as straight as you can. Stick to the truth. The other thing truth is capable of doing is putting us in the light. We kind of talked about that in our Bible class in Colossians this morning. We'll look at the NIV translation of this passage we've already looked at, John 3:21. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. You know, I think as a kid, I know I was definitely scared of the dark. And you get a little bit older and you kind of learn to deal with the dark. And I'll tell you, I've recently been volunteer firefighting for the last year. And in some of the classes I've been in, they've reintroduced me to what it means to be scared of the dark. Where they've thrown us in this structure I've never been in before. They've completely smoked it up to where it's completely dark and you can't see anything. And it's scary. You don't know where you're going. You can't see anything. You're running into stuff. You can only feel. Darkness is not a place that I want to be. And I doubt it's a place that you want to be as well. The truth is able to give us the light in a world that has so much darkness in it. And going along with that, the truth is going to expose the fact that we are in the darkness. If you look over at the first chapter of John, as John is introducing us to the idea of who Jesus is, one of the things uniquely to John that he does at the beginning, look what he says about Jesus there in John 1, verse 4. Talking about Jesus, he says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There's really one of two options when the light goes to shine in the darkness that you're living in. Either one, you're going to appreciate it and say, thank you for showing me the darkness that I'm in. I need to make changes. Or there are going to be some, as John said, who don't appreciate the darkness. When does the majority of crime happen? It happens at night. Happens in the darkness. What's the last thing that thief wants? A light to be shined on him, to expose the deeds that he's doing. If we love the truth, we want the darkness to be exposed in our lives. We want to let the word expose those things so that we can make the changes that we need to. These are the things that the truth is able to do. Well, the second question, which is just as important, is how do we determine the truth? There seems to be so many different people who have an opinion on this. How are we going to determine it in the first place? Well, for starters, we got to go to the right standard. We know there are a lot of different standards for truth out there. And I would say that's the reason for so much divide in our country and across all of the world altogether is people are going to different standards of truth. But as those who follow Jesus Christ, we know who our standard is. It's Jesus himself. He is the ultimate standard. Right there in John 1, if you skip down a few verses to verse 17, the law was given through Moses, grace and what? Truth were realized through Jesus Christ. In John the 14th chapter, turn several chapters over, as Jesus is having this conversation with his disciples. Thomas will ask him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. We have to go to Jesus. It's the ultimate standard. And I'll ask you, how often are you reading the words of Jesus? I think any Bible reading plan that's worth its salt has the words of Jesus in it at least once a week, hopefully once a day. There's four different gospels. Pick a different one each month and rotate through. Get the words of Christ in your life as he is the ultimate standard. But the other really cool thing is that Jesus, it wasn't just him that he left behind, but he left other things behind as well. He's given us the helper, as it says. Look over at chapter 16 of John. John chapter 16, excuse me. John chapter 16, in verse 5, we're going to read this whole section, so please bear with me as we do this. John chapter 16, verse 5. This is in Jesus' final conversation with his disciples before he'll be crucified. He says, but now I am going to him who sent me, and none of you ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Look at this in verse 7. But I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. And concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father and you no longer see me. And concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world has been judged. I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of mine and will disclose it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he takes of mine and will disclose it to you. Does anyone else get a little bit nervous whenever they're reading through the Gospels and you kind of take a look at what the disciples are and what they're doing and you go, how are these guys going to be able to accurately and effectively carry out this mission that Jesus has handed down to them? To the very end, they're all doubting Jesus. They run from him in the garden. How are they going to be able to get this together? I believe many of them are having the same concern as well. And Jesus promises something to them here in his last conversation, that they will have the helper. The Holy Spirit will be there to guide them, to tell them what to say. It's the same thing Jesus had said in Matthew, the 10th chapter, as I know you all have been going through Matthew in your adult class as well, that even when they're before kings and in the synagogues and other places, it will be given to them in that moment what they need to say. Jesus did not leave them alone, but he gave them the Spirit of truth so that they would know what to say in the moment of trial. I think that's a real blessing. And that Spirit of truth really goes back to who Jesus is and what he had been preaching and what he had been teaching. This is something that Paul clearly states. Look over at Ephesians chapter 3. If you're ever studying with somebody, by the way, that believes that they're getting direct revelation from God and you just want to show them maybe what the scriptures say about that, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 4 through 6 is a great place to go with them. Because Paul, as an apostle of Jesus Christ, explains to them how he gets the revelation. Look at Ephesians 3, verse 4. By referring to this, when you read, you can understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which in other generations was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets in the Spirit. To be specific, that the Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Do you see the order that Paul laid out there? As the Spirit is revealing the truth to Paul, he writes it down so that then you can read it and understand the mystery. And of course, by the way, the mystery in Ephesians is never veiled. It's very clear that the Gentiles are now fellow heirs of the salvation of Jesus Christ. It's not some mysterious, spooky thing or some notion or emotion that Paul gets when he writes down. He's saying, this Spirit tells me. So listen to it. Are you listening to the Spirit of truth? Do you recognize and understand the authority that comes behind the apostles of Jesus Christ as they write what the Spirit of truth has to say? It's supposed to be our helper. So we need to go back to it as our standard, not come up with our own. And if I can just say a couple further things about the apostles themselves. If you ever think about the authority of the apostles, they really do say some startling things. The apostle Paul, but especially the apostle John. Look over at 1 John chapter 2. We're just going to look at two examples of a couple things that John says. 1 John chapter 2. If you can find the book of Revelation and go left, you'll find those little epistles. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 21. John, in his writings, he gives a lot of reasons why he writes. I think it's kind of funny. He'll just, every chapter just about, he'll say, oh, and I wrote this because, and I wrote this because. This is one of those instances. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 21. I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie is of the truth. Who is the liar but the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, the one who denies the Father and the Son. John says, you guys already know the truth. It's already been given to you, as they are also being challenged with Gnosticism and another false doctrine. But more specifically, look over at chapter 4 and verse 6. Look at what John says here. It's startling that anyone can say this other than John or the apostles. 1 John 4, verse 6. We are from God. He who knows God listens to us. He who is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Well, why does John get to say this and Chase doesn't? Why doesn't Chase get to look at verse 6 and say, Chase is from God, and he who knows God listens to me. He who is not from God does not listen to me. Why doesn't Chase get to say that? Because I'm not an apostle of Jesus Christ. I wasn't with him. You all remember what apostle means? Sent out ones. They were sent out by Jesus himself. And the reason why I'm emphasizing this so much is because as I think about some of those brethren, some of the men that have stood in this pulpit, and some of the others that have left the truth, as I've had conversations with them, you're going to run into a lot of people like that who say that they know Jesus. And they say that I know what Paul said, and I know what John said, and I know what Jesus said, but I'm getting something different. Take them to a passage like this and just very humbly and simply ask them, do you know Jesus the way the Apostle John did? Or the Apostle Peter? Or the Apostle Paul? I sure hope their answer is no, because they don't. They've now come up with their own standard or gone to another one. From the standard of Jesus Christ and his apostles. Stick with that one. Safest bet you'll ever make. This is why in Acts 2:42, after those 3,000 are baptized, what are they devoting themselves to? The apostles' teaching, to the breaking of bread, to prayer and to fellowship. Obviously, I'm emphasizing they are sticking to the apostles' doctrine and teaching. Not some other standard, but the apostles'. And so the application for us is simple. Teach God's standard, not yours. Don't stand up here and spout off your opinion. I mean this with all due respect. No one cares. I hope no one in here cares. If you want to talk little ins and outs about the Bible, that's fun and that's exciting. I do that a lot. Let's do it out there. But when we're standing up here, when we're talking about truth, let it be God's standard, not your own. And never settle for anything else than that. The second we start to settle, that's when false teachers will weasel their way in. And we'll be ripe for the plucking if we're not careful. Number three, the third question with this is what do we do with those who no longer love the truth? That's a reality. What does the Bible say happens next? Do we just keep tolerating them? Do we keep giving them high fives and hugs and acting like everything's okay? Far from that. For starters, we got to call them out. Out of Paul's epistles, you realize all of them just about, he's calling people out for false teaching. And we'll use Galatians as a simple example. Man, he's rough on the Galatians. Look over at Galatians chapter 1. not but six verses in, he starts off by telling them that he's disappointed in them. And it's not so much he's disappointed in them with their sinful lifestyle or anything like that, but it's because of the false teaching that they're tolerating. Galatians 1 and verse 6, he says, "I'm amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we've preached to you, he is to be accursed." Paul's talking about Judaizing here and that prominent false teaching in the church in that day. But he's shocked that they've even left in that moment. He'll call them foolish Galatians in chapter 3 and verse 1. And as Paul is trying to emphasize to them how foolish this doctrine is, he uses himself as an example in chapter 2 and verse 5. And I want you to see what Paul said about this false doctrine. Chapter 2 and verse 5, he says, "But we did not yield in subjection to them for even an hour, so that the truth of the gospel would remain with you." I love that. Paul didn't even entertain the idea that Judaizing was a true and accurate doctrine, not even for an hour. You know, sometimes we excuse brethren who are going into false teaching and false doctrine. And we say things like, "Well, I know they're teaching this and thinking this and studying this, but I don't want to do more damage. I don't want to discourage them by bringing down the hammer on that false teaching." Sometimes we might say, "Well, they'll study themselves out of that thinking. They'll get far enough and they'll realize that that's just foolishness." Not always. Or maybe sometimes we say, "We should just be open-minded to what they have to say." And let me just say, that's coming from an honest heart, I think. Should we be open-minded? Does everyone agree with that? Well, sure, the Bereans, they were open-minded and searching the scriptures daily, whether to see these things were so in Acts 17. Yes, we are to be open-minded, but we are also to be convicted. We should get to the point that we know the truth so well that when the counterfeit is spotted, we immediately throw it out. Do not entertain it. And call brethren out when you do that, when they're departing from the truth. Here's what I love about Galatians. Look over at chapter 4 and verse 16. It's a rhetorical question Paul asked them, but I love it. "So have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? You are not my enemy when you call me out. You are my friend." And everyone in this auditorium should have that attitude. That if someone calls you out for living in a way that's false and is not worthy of the gospel call, they are not your enemy, but they're your friend. And more than a friend, they're your brother or sister. They're looking out for you. And sandwiched in between chapter 1 and chapter 4, Paul uses an example of that where he had to call the apostle Peter out for what he said in chapter 2 and verse 14. I thought that was cool how it was worded this way. Was not being straightforward about the truth of the gospel. Paul called them out. And Peter was better for it. We need to be willing to do that. Don't come up with excuses on why. I'm not going to bring it up. Now here's the caveat, hopefully everyone was anticipating. There's a way we do this. We're not mean about it. We're not a jerk. The scriptures speak to how we bring this to someone's attention. And if you want to stick in the book of Galatians, you can look at chapter 6 and verse 1, when Paul said, "Brethren, if anyone's caught in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of what? Gentleness." You be gentle with them. I think there are some brethren who are walking around thinking every brother's a nail and they're the hammer. Be careful. Be gentle with them. I love how Paul will put this to Timothy in the section we were in earlier in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 24, as he's talking about what the Lord's bondservant is to be. 2 Timothy 2, verse 24. the Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wrong, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition. If perhaps God may grant them repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth, so that they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Remember, as you're talking to that brother or sister who's in false doctrine or in false living, they're in the snare of the devil. That's where they are. So be gentle with them as you are striving to bring them back to the truth. As Paul will say in Ephesians, speak the truth in love with them and be patient with them. Be gentle. I say be gentle in the pulpit, but I think the more I say that word is to my daughter, Sally. As I see her play with her toys, she's got this little farm thing she plays with, and she's trying to get the cow to go down the chute, and she shoves it in there and she's trying to get it to go out and trying to get the toy to do what she wants. She needs to slow down. She wants the end result, but she's doing it too rough. I hate using this analogy with my family because they know that's exactly how I am too. Working on cars, working on house stuff. I think that's why I excelled in concrete work, because you could, for the most part, just be rough. But I'll tell you what, that's not the way we need to be with brethren. Be gentle. Put yourself in their shoes. If this was me, how would I want this topic to be approached? How would I want to be talked to? Would I want to be talked down to, or would I want to be talked to as an equal, as someone that loves me and respects me? Think about those things as you go to approach them. But thirdly, if there's a refusal to turn back to the truth, there are steps that the Bible is very clear about here. In 2 Thessalonians 3, as Paul has just had to crack the whip on these fellas about not working, he'll tell them that if you don't obey our instruction, take special note of that person and do not associate with them, so that he will be put to shame. Yet do not regard him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. This is the same point Paul will make in 1 Corinthians 5, and both of those are really rooted in what Jesus said in Matthew, the 18th chapter. Go to your brother first, take two or three witnesses, and if they don't listen, they are to be as a Gentile. This is not an easy command. It's hard to withdraw from someone that you love. But the end result that we're looking for is that they will see, because you've damaged your relationship with God, you've damaged your relationship with me. And it's all reflecting back to what they've done to God. Be gentle, correct them, call them out, but be ready and willing to obey this passage if they refuse to turn back to the truth. Because this is God's will for his church. And this is a lesson I did with our local congregation, if I can just sidestep and make that point. Because as a young congregation ourselves, thanks be to God, we have yet had to do this process. But we know it might come, and it probably will come. And so we've been doing a lot of teaching and preaching so that when it does come, everyone's prepared and everyone knows this is what happens. This is God's will for his church. And then the last question we'll ask this morning, or I guess the last thing, it's just looking at responses to the truth. If you brought the truth to somebody, how are they going to respond to it? The very first response we'll talk about is just outright disbelief. This is one Jesus was used to, wasn't he? Look over at John chapter 8 and verse 43. Can you guess which group of people Jesus dealt the most with that disbelieved? The Pharisees, right? And Jesus will eventually get so fed up with them. This is one of the things he says to them, and I think it's quite interesting. John 8 and verse 43. Jesus says to the Pharisees here, why do you not understand what I am saying? It is because you cannot hear my word. Because you are the father of your father, the devil. And you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I speak the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I speak truth, why do you not believe me? He who is of God hears the words of God. For this reason, you do not hear them because you are not of God. This was so evident in Jesus' ministry.
So much so that when Jesus did a miracle, they said, you were only able to do that because you're of the devil. Looking a clear miracle in the face and saying, there's no way he did that. That's the kind of disbelief that we might run into with different people. And what Jesus is pointing out here is that they really actually do have belief, but it's belief in their Father, and not Father God, but their father is the devil. What was one of the other famous names for the devil in the scriptures? The great deceiver. Is that not exactly what he did in the garden to Eve? All he had to do was alter her way of looking at the truth to get her to fall. And that's all he has to do to us as well. So much so, in Romans, the first chapter in verse 25, as Paul is describing the sin of the Gentiles, he will say that they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. Is Satan doing that to you right now? If you have some disbelief in your heart, the best thing you can do, and I mean this, is voice it. One of the worst things you can do with doubt is to suppress it and not say anything. Stop thinking about other people being disappointed and hearing that you've been doubting your faith. Stop thinking that way. And realize that your brethren will be all the more happy if you will only voice that disbelief that you have and go to the right standard to find the answer. If you're doubting, don't hide it. Be willing to share that. The other thing I think some people do with the truth is just simply lower it. They lower the standard altogether. We're going to hang on to this form of the truth. We're going to hang on to this idea of Jesus, but they kind of lower the standard altogether. If I said, hey, everyone, we're going to skip lunch. Let's head down to Rupp Arena. I got access. You guys are going to watch me dunk a basketball. Would everyone be excited to see that? I'm 6 foot tall, not like 6'8" or anything. Not as skinny as I used to be. Not convince everyone that you're going to go see me dunk a basketball, and we get to Rupp Arena and this is on the court. And I'm over there dunking on it. You guys are a first concern for me. But two, what are you going to say to me? You've lowered the standard. This is the type of Christianity some people are following and preaching and teaching. If we can just say, I just had a Bible study with someone like this last week. If we can just say things like, well, you know, Jesus never actually condemned homosexuality. Is that true? Did Jesus ever use the word homosexual? No. Well, he did condemn homosexuality in Matthew 19. But can you kind of see that kind of thinking creeping into someone's thinking? If we can just lower the standard, if we can just sugarcoat it, if we can just water it down a little bit, it'll be more palatable for people and we can get people to come and it can be great. No. All you've done is just lowered the standard and departed from the truth. And so the third thing we can do, and that's exactly what Paul is saying in 2 Timothy 4, that people are going to heap up for themselves teachers according to their own desires and wanting to have their ears tickled. They'll have whatever they want taught. But the third response to truth, and the ideal one, is to simply obey. As Paul, using his language, you were running well, who hindered you from obeying the truth? This is rooted in the armor in Ephesians 6. Stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth. Obey it. Listen to it. Hang on to it. Don't depart from it. And yet that's what we see people do all the time. My nanny, my mom's mom, used to go here years ago, when we were still in the building that was in the parking lot at one time. And she gave me my very first Bible, little old King James Version, I still have it. And she highlighted one verse in that Bible for me. 3 John 4. I have no greater joy than this, to hear of my children walking in the truth. Obey it. Listen to it. Don't leave it. And if you have left it and you know it,
Stop staying in the darkness. Come back to the light of Jesus Christ. Because that's what Jesus' final prayer for us was. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. And that's my prayer for this congregation. Don't leave it. I appreciate your all's kind attention this morning. We now have an opportunity, and it goes well with the lesson this morning, for anyone who has been dwelling in the darkness to come to the light. You have an opportunity to walk out of the darkness right now. Believe in the light of Jesus Christ. Repent of your sins and be baptized, having those sins washed away. You can do that this morning. For all those in here that are Christians, and there's a lot of us in here, maybe you've left the light altogether. And you need prayers. And you need to confess the darkness that you're in. This is another good opportunity to do that. Everyone in this room loves you. Everyone in this room wants to see you do what's right. Why not confess that sin to God and to your brethren today? Why not do that right now? If we can help you in any way, won't you come forward now as we stand and as we sing?